is infused with 2 times more natural essential oil. It's our most amazing, true-to-nature fragrance experience ever. New Vibrant from Airwick.
From the station that's on your side, this is News 12, First at 5.
Heated cross-examination today in the Alec Murdoch murder trial. We'll take you there next, live at 5.
But first, here one day, gone the next. The sudden death of a 13-year-old has rocked the community. Last Sunday, Julia Chavez complained about her ear hurting and passed out shortly after that. Next thing, she's being rushed to the hospital and doctors are fighting to save her life.
As our Nick Veland tells us, her family is now mourning her life gone so quickly.
Yeah, and I talked with her family, and they say Juju loved Pokemon, unicorns, and rainbows. She loved the bright colors, which is why they encourage everyone at her funeral today to wear pink or other colors of the rainbow. Juju would sing and dance every opportunity she had. She was a straight A and B student who never got into any trouble. Her mom says now the whole family just misses Juju, a 13-year-old who never met a stranger and wanted everyone to be her friend.
Leo was a light in any room. She never knew a stranger. She'd walk up to anybody and, hi, how are you? Her woman, oh, you're so beautiful. She just loved people. She was the first one to make friends with somebody. If she saw somebody that was sitting alone or didn't have or seemed to have friends around, she'd jump into action and she had to know them.
And coming up all new on News 12 at 6 o'clock, I'll have more on how the family is remembering Juju and what they're looking to do moving forward to make sure they'll never forget her.
Just a tragic story there. Thanks for that update there, Nick. Turning to weather now, we're taking next week's forecast for you in just about 10 minutes. Thanks, Riley. Now to Alabama, we're getting our first look at two pilots who died in a helicopter crash earlier this week. This is Chief Warrant Officer Daniel Wadum and Chief Warrant Officer Danny Randolph. Both men had more than a dozen years of service and were based at Nashville's Berryfield Air National Guard Base. The crash is still under investigation. The security camera footage here shows the Black Hawk when it crashed in northern Alabama. The Tennessee National Guard says the helicopter came from a base in Nashville.
The prosecution has rested. On the final day of the state's case against Alec Murdoch, a SLED agent went minute by minute through a reconstructed timeline using phone records and vehicle data from Alec, Maggie, and Paul Murdoch.
Nick Neville walks us through some of the key takeaways. All this data reinforces and lays out plainly for the jury inconsistencies in Murdoch's timeline from the night of the murders. It lays out how Murdoch's phone went dark for much of that evening and also how he deleted dozens of calls from his phone. But perhaps the biggest revelation is the fact that Murdoch calls 911 just 20 seconds after his car pulls up to the crime scene, with prosecutors alleging that that wouldn't have been enough time to check both bodies for pulses. Murdoch's phone shows no steps from 8:09 p.m. until approximately 9:02. He claims to have been napping at this time, but several witnesses have identified his voice at the crime scene in a video taken by Paul at 8:44.
Did the defendant repeatedly deny ever being at the kennels? Is that contrary?
Yes, he did. Various interviews with law enforcement.
Phone records indicate that both Maggie Murdoch and Paul Murdoch's phones were locked forever at 8:49. Prosecutors displayed a pay spreadsheet that shows Alec's fastest steps of the day by far are just minutes later, right before his Suburban cranks up.
He was a busy guy right then, wasn't he?
Yeah.
The timeline then reveals Murdoch's high-speed trip to his mother's house, with speeds up to 74 miles per hour. It shows he was there for 20 minutes, not 45 minutes to an hour, as he later told investigators.
Was the defendant's top speeds on both the trip to and from Alameda in excess of his any max speed in his trips previous in the day?
That'd be correct.
Murdoch's timeline further tightens as when he arrives at the kennels, he calls 911 seconds later, despite telling law enforcement that he checked Maggie and Paul's pulses and tried to turn Paul over.
From the moment Suburban arrived at the kennels, how long did it take for that 911 call to be made?
Less than 20 seconds.
On cross-examination of Agent Radofsky, the defense sought to explain this quick 911 call by saying Murdoch's headlights could have illuminated the bloody crime scene, causing him to run to the bodies. They then set a timer for 20 seconds, implying that this would have been enough time for him to check both Maggie and Paul's pulses. In Walterboro, I'm Nick Neville.
Well, the recovery operation for the suspected Chinese spy.
After several hours of testimony, state lawmakers are still unclear about a $3.5 billion accounting error. South Carolina's Comptroller General struggled to create a clear timeline about the problem. The chair of the Senate Finance Subcommittee probing the issue said he lost confidence in the Comptroller General Richard Ekstrom's ability to answer questions about the balance. Republican Senator Larry Grooms expressed concern that the office failed its primary duty of producing an accurate annual financial report from at least 2017 to 2022 under Ekstrom. The panel will continue its investigation next Thursday at another meeting. Under a new bill lawmakers are debating in South Carolina, students could attend any public school in the state, whether it's in their home district or it's not. That means kids in Aiken or Edgefield, for example, could go to school every day, say, in Greenville.
And our State House reporter Mary Green explains how that would work.
This open enrollment bill is another form of school choice with support here at the State House. But as opposed to the more controversial school voucher bill that recently passed to the Senate and now awaits a hearing in the House of Representatives, this bill has the backing of at least one teacher advocacy group.
Any mechanism of choice needs to meet three criteria. It's got to be affordable, accessible, and accountable. And an open enrollment bill that allows students increased access to public schooling options is the truest and purest form of educational choice.
This bill would create open enrollment statewide in South Carolina. That means a student could attend the public school of their choosing as long as there's space, and regardless of if it's in their district or even county where they live. Students who are zoned for a particular school would still be guaranteed a spot there. Schools with more demand than space would give priority to students based on criteria, including those who already have a sibling attending or whose parents work at that school. Then a lottery would determine who else can attend. Schools could provide transportation to students living outside their zone, but they wouldn't be required to.
We don't define it so that it's not a one-size-fits-all, because that defeats the purpose. But they can figure out how that best fits.
Public schools operate off a combination of federal, state, and local funding, with the local money coming from property taxes of people who live in that district. This bill would keep those local dollars in that district, even if a student enrolls in a school outside of where they live, while the state and federal funding would go with the student to their new school. Reporting from the State House, I'm Mary Green.
Thanks, Mary. The House version of this bill advanced out of a subcommittee this week.
A similar Senate version has not yet gotten a hearing. Two men are alive after a plane crash in Georgia. Next, live at 5, we talk to witnesses that heard it go down. Riley?
Well, we are expecting a cold night, but the cold air is not going to stick around too long. We'll have a full look at that forecast for you just after the break.
All new on News 12 at 6 o'clock, we're taking a closer look at a man who was arrested yesterday at an Augusta trampoline park for licking the toes of a minor.
The National Weather Service says one tornado touched down in West Georgia during overnight storms. They say the brief spin-up tornado happened in Troup County just before 4:30 this morning. No ruling yet on the tornado's intensity, but the damage came from either a high EF0 or low-end EF1 storm.
New video showing the massive trees just completely uprooted there. Look, the area impacted is near LaGrange College, a little more than an hour southwest of Atlanta. We're told no one was hurt, but the home there was destroyed.
Unfortunately, yeah, luckily we had no storms like that move into our area, and it's looking pretty good for us this weekend. Maybe just a little chilly, but yeah, it's better than having a lot of rain like we've been having over the past few weekends, it seems like.
I know. Finally, a dry weekend for us. Temperatures in the 80s next Wednesday and Thursday.
Thanks, Riley. A Georgia pilot and an aviation student are recovering after their plane suddenly went down after takeoff at the DeKalb Peachtree Airport yesterday afternoon.
Tonight, live at 5, witnesses are speaking out. Tori Cooper sat down with them and shares their story.
At
2:30 in the afternoon. It was time for takeoff at the DeKalb Peachtree Airport.
Shortly after takeoff, we noticed the plane had some engine trouble.
Ryan Sullivan is a local pilot who was having lunch at the nearby 57th Fighter Restaurant Group next to the airport when he says he saw a small single-engine Piper plane having trouble getting off the ground.
Sounded like a total loss of power. Turned back towards the airport to try to make an emergency landing, but unfortunately ended up wide of the runway. Looked like the port wing hit first and kind of pirouetted over.
Rescue crews rushed to the scene where they found an adult male pilot and his male student who was a minor on board with injuries. The two were taken to the hospital.
It was his son on that plane.
Johnny, who works at the 57th Fighter Restaurant Group, says one of his customers claimed to be a family member of one of the passengers.
He just broke down in my arms and I kissed him on the top of the head. I said, look, I said, it's okay. There's no fire or anything. I said, leave your stuff. I said, go.
Centennial Aviation Academy operates out of the DeKalb Peachtree Airport training new pilots. The academy owns the plane, and they confirm the plane lost power during takeoff. They say the pilot and the student are expected to make a full recovery thanks to the pilot's swift emergency landing.
Saw two people get out of the airplane and walk away, so hopefully all is well with them.
But coming up, would you think about skipping insurance and instead paying your doctor a flat monthly fee? Next, live at 5, we have more on the push to end surprise billing.
Investigate
comfortably.
There should be less surprise billing and more transparency about how much you're actually going to pay when it comes to your medical care.
In Georgia, lawmakers and doctors agree. Rachel Argon explains one doctor stopped accepting insurance and is only charging his patients a flat fee.
For the last 2 months, Dr. Nick Boyer has been able to see his patients however they want, as many times as they want, for $100 a month.
It's unlimited care. So it doesn't mean you have to come in, but you can get a text, you can get an email, you do whatever it is, it produces efficiency.
His Atlanta practice has served the community for 19 years, but recently they decided to nix private insurance and move to a fee-based service to keep their doors open.
This is survival. The reason why we don't have community primary care physicians anymore because the model is no longer functional.
While the monthly fee model is a way to weather labor costs and inflation, it also means no surprises for the patient. No co-pays, deductibles, or mysterious bills.
For the first time in medicine, there's transparency around the billing.
It's something that lawmakers right now are working to strengthen.
As often people don't even know that there is such thing as an in or out-of-network ambulance company.
Representative Michelle Au, who is also a practicing physician, is sponsoring a bill that would protect patients from surprise billing.
The bill would ensure that the insurance company would cover the cost of the emergency medical transport as though they are in-network. Right, at in-network rates.
She says the mere surprise and the cost for coverage will push some people to avoid critical care.
I don't want to be the next patient who gets stuck with a $2,000, a $5,000, a $30,000 bill, right? So they avoid medical care and end up having much worse health outcomes.
It's an interesting concept. At first you want to say, well, what if I never go to the doctor?
Which is what I said.
Right, and I said, well, what if you do go to the doctor and suddenly you need a lot of care, you know that you're going to only spend X amount of $100 a month. That's $1,200 for the year.
Yeah.
That's probably less than you're spending. It's just in insurance.
It is definitely a talker, something that both people could argue on both sides.
Yeah, so an interesting option. We're getting a new look at the almost completed Assembly Atlanta. Our parent company, Gray Television, is behind the 135-acre mixed-use complex. It sits at the former site of the General Motors Assembly Plant in Doraville, solidifying Georgia as the new Hollywood of the South. This won't just be a spot for major TV shows and movies to be made. The developer says people will be able to live, work, and even play at the site.
Having that interaction between the studios where you're not sitting behind a 12-foot wall and you're kind of right there on Main Street was just, it was novel, it was unique, but it also makes it filmable.
How cool is that? Teams at the site say the plan is to open the first sound stage in about 3.5 months, so who knows? It could be the next big TV show and movie location, Riley.
Hey, it looks pretty cool there. Definitely love the renderings. We're looking at a nice weekend, staying nice and dry, upper 50s tomorrow, 60s again by Sunday. Have a look at an even warmer outlook next week, just after the break.
We know. Whether you're a farmer, hunter, contractor, or weekend warrior, North Augusta Customs is your authority in trucking accessories. From hitches to step bars, toolboxes to tonneau covers, leather interiors, or window tinting, North Augusta Customs is committed to being your go-to shop. Your exclusive dealer of spray-on bed liners and truck gear accessories by Lighthouse, both backed by a nationwide lifetime warranty. North Augusta Customs, located just across the river on Jefferson Davis Highway and on nacustoms.com.
The sitting motherfucker.